Hello. Welcome to Connie Martins and Talks Books. My guest today, Richard Kramer, has looked at the American family, but the changing American family. And the book is called These Things Happened. And welcome, Richard.
Welcome. Thank you. Happy to be here.
Who published your book?
Unbridled.
And the book is truly an unbridled book.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Let's tell our friends a little bit about Wesley and his best friend, Theo, and how the book opens.
Okay.
All right.
I'd be happy to jump in. The book is told in a series of first-person voices of the main characters in the book. Mm-hmm. Some people get more than one chapter, the main characters. In the very last chapter, it goes into the third person.
Yeah.
And becomes a little bit broader. But
and more threatening.
And more threatening, yeah.
Yeah.
It's interesting. That's an interesting reaction to it. A little bit more dangerous, I would
mm-hmm.
think. But Wesley is an almost 16-year-old boy in New York City who has the interesting situation of being what a gay couple and a straight couple have in common. That began, I'll just give you a little bit of a side thing. Somebody quoted to me years ago something that D.H. Lawrence said, which he said, all good stories should be about two couples.
Yeah.
It's kind of a great setup. And
yeah.
So I put these two couples, you know, the straight couple is his mother and his stepfather.
Lola and Ben.
And the gay couple is composed of his father, Kenny, and his father's partner of 10 years, George.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Wesley has been living since he was three with his mother and his stepfather on the Upper East Side. And he sees his father, who is a very prominent sort of gay rights lawyer, who is everybody's right-hand man,
mm-hmm.
who is always on shows like this as the face of acceptable gayness.
Mm-hmm.
But Wesley doesn't know him well. He is always, you know, at a meeting, always in another state. And he gets the idea that he would like to go live with his father as he is getting older, because he wants to know his father as a man.
Yeah.
And everybody's kind of okay with this.
Yeah.
Pretends to be okay with this. And Wesley has a best friend whose name is Theo, who has been his friend since in utero, as they say, because the mothers met in Lamaze class. And Theo is an original, independent thinker who, as the book starts, has just stunned the world of his fancy private school and his best friend Wesley by, after winning the 10th grade presidency, announcing that he is also gay, which Wesley didn't know.
Yeah. I mean, well, at that age, you're just coming into puberty and out of puberty.
Absolutely.
And there was a girl who he was running against.
Shannon, yes.
And, I mean, it was just sort of like, I felt like I was in the audience when he said it. Because
were you stunned by it?
Yeah, because kids usually don't trumpet it to the world.
Well, it's interesting. I will not be indiscreet here, but it is based on the son of a very famous writer. And I will tell you who that is after we stop taping.
Well, I think it's he's written about it.
He hasn't, actually.
Oh, somebody else has.
Yes.
Okay,
yes,
so
it's not that.
It's not unusual.
It's not. Well, it was unusual when I first heard about it, which was about 20 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And I was stunned when I heard it because I said, kids just don't do that. They do it more often now. But this kid was a pioneer. I know people who were in his class at that school who to this day said it was the most memorable day of their entire education. And that is the basis of Theo.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, in some ways when you're writing a book, they're all you, whether you realize it or not. But that was the first spark of who Theo was. I said, my God, that kid must have had such courage to do that and such bravado.
But it now puts his friend, Wesley, in what could be called guilt by association.
Absolutely. And it also makes him feel, why didn't my best friend confide in me?
Yeah.
And Theo explains, and this doesn't ruin anything in the book, but Theo explains that he didn't know he was going to do it.
Yeah.
You know, he said it sort of surprised him. Yeah.
And also, in this day and age, and I have a theory that half of the problems that used to occur about different sex marriages was when people who were gay, female or male, could have children. Mm-hmm. So that the past generation didn't feel it ended. Mm-hmm. That it was a continuity of relationships.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, this is a kid, interestingly enough, who's not thinking that far in the future.
No, I know.
And who's never even had sex.
Yeah.
Which is what I think is so bold about it and also so delicious about it, is that he's not a sexually experienced kid by a long shot. He's had no sexual experience. So when he tells the, he says, in the interest of personal transparency, he says, using, you know, co-opting political language, I would like to say that I also am, quite frankly, a gay guy.
Yeah.
And it's as much a statement of world, here I am, as it's a statement of that I'm a gay person.
Yeah. Now, they also live in that area of New York of theater.
Partly.
Yeah.
Partly.
But it's enough that it transpires over the group.
Absolutely.
Over the area.
There's a theatrical sense that the people have. And that's part of my sense of New York, which is a city that I grew up in and haven't lived in for 37 years. But it's still so vivid in me what New York is. And one of the things that's pleased me most about this book is that New Yorkers who have read it have told me, it's so New York. And I just said, well, it's New York 37 years ago and the New York of my fantasy.
Oh, I think it's New York today anyhow.
Does it feel that to you?
Anyhow, we get to the fact that Kenny and George live over a restaurant called Echo.
Echo, E-C-C-O, which means here is in Italian.
Yeah, and George is a very special human.
I'm glad you feel that way, because I do.
Yeah.
Why do you think that? How did you?
Oh, because the way he cooks, the way he has the restaurant, the way he uses it as if it were his theater.
Yes, exactly.
And I've known so many people who had been in theater, and they have their pictures on the wall playing Cyrano de Bergerac and all of that George has.
Mm-hmm.
And he loves Kenny.
He loves him very much.
Yeah. But he knows he could be hurt.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
No, who knows? George knows Kenny could be hurt?
No, he knows he could be hurt.
He could be hurt by Kenny.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because George is extremely warm naturally.
Yeah.
And Kenny is by nature more removed.
Cut off.
He's cut off from his feelings.
Yeah.
And he's in agony about it, which we find out as the book goes on.
Yeah.
But he knows it. He's the kind of person who walks into a room and senses, even though everybody is impressed with him, that they're not comfortable with him.
Yeah. And his son is trying to find out, when did you know you were gay?
Mm-hmm.
How did you know you were gay? And Theo has sort of put him up to asking these questions.
Yes, he has. But what's great about, you read this very, very richly. What's great about Theo's question is it actually starts the plot moving.
Yeah.
Because it plants a seed of suspicion in Kenny, the father, that Wesley might be gay.
Yeah.
And here you have this, I set up a situation for the adults in this where I made them the most progressive, tolerant, famously liberal people who
until
it hits home.
Yeah, yeah.
Until it hits home.
It's all well and good, but
not in
my backyard.
Not him, please, yes.
But you also set it up that Lola and Ben, Ben has a son who died, who was gay.
Yeah, who died of AIDS.
Yeah.
And that was because after all this time being away from New York, my sense of the city, and it's one I tried to capture here, is that it's almost like Thornton Wilder's Our Town. That it is that everybody is connected to everybody else in however subtle a fashion.
Yeah.
And that it's there's a great quote from another great English writer, but I thought about it when I was doing this, from Georgia Eliot. She writes in Middlemarch, and I had this taped to my computer. She says, touch the web of Middlemarch, which is a town, touch the web of Middlemarch at any point, and the entire web resounds.
Yeah.
And so New York was my Middlemarch.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't want to do a thing about how towering and overwhelming the city is. I wanted to do a story about how intimate and small it was.
Yeah. It is. I mean, you know, it's sort of like 12 degrees of separation.
Yes, exactly, which is a play that I love and that I actually read before I wrote this as inspiration. My mind went to that. Yes.
Did you play any music while you were writing?
Only the music in my head.
Yeah.
Did you hear music while you were reading it?
Well, it was, you know, the shows in New York.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Anything particular that popped out for you?
Well, you use it here anyhow. What is it? Dance? I mean, Robert Fosse and
And there's also the Gypsy Overture, which is very central to these people.
Yeah.
And I had a soundtrack, you know, really in my head the whole time.
Yeah. Who was it? Jerry Robbins, who had them all come and chorus line tell their story.
Yes.
And then used it. Well, a lot of
that's in the book.
I guess
a chorus line that pops up later.
Yeah. George is put in the most intangible position when they all meet for dinner. Mm-hmm. You have to say that Theo and Wesley have been really beaten. It's lucky they stayed alive.
Yes.
By what happens with the bullies who can't stand that a young boy can be theatrical, gay, what have you.
And there are ironies that are contained within that, because Theo is not particularly theatrical.
Yeah.
You know, Theo is not somebody who, he could have hidden it if he wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
And I needed something upsetting to happen, or else it would have just been too light a domestic comedy. And that's not what I wanted to write. And the word is gay bashed is really what happens. And Wesley gets gay bashed by association.
Yeah.
And this is set in a fancy private school in New York. I mean, it's I don't want to say which one, but because it's partly imagined, but it's also, I could tell you what it is. And I thought, is this realistic? Would this have happened in an exclusive private school? And I called the Anti-Bullying Initiative in New York City.
Yeah.
And I said, is this believable to you? They said, it happens everywhere, and it happens every day, and there's no socioeconomic lines that it does not cross.
Yeah.
And it is endemic, and it is a huge problem, and kids are really, really screwed up by it when it happens.
Wesley comes out of the hospital.
Yes.
Theo is left in the hospital.
He's very badly hurt, yes.
Yeah, I was surprised he'd lived.
Yes.
I thought, the author has guts.
Mm-hmm.
Because it would have been easier and more melodramatic to have him expire.
I never thought of that. And that's one of the things that I enjoy about talking to people about this, is hearing how they might have written the book. Because I only, some people said, why didn't you set this scene here, or why didn't you have this scene between these two people? Because it never occurred to me. And I'm always fascinated that would have been a very different way to go.
Yeah.
But a valid way to go.
Mm-hmm.
That never occurred to me at all.
Yeah. When you say some people have talked to you, how many people did you have read your book before it was published?
Not too many. I mean, I have a core group. Mm-hmm. Of people who I worked, who are my dear friends.
Can I say you worked on 30-something?
Yeah.
And some of the other shows?
I worked on some of the TV shows I worked on, and these are my core readers.